things that's a little bit difficult about the idea of what love is we have a lot of different concepts of love today. Culturally speaking, when we talk about being in love, right? You know, that's a common expression, you know, I've fallen in love. We often think of love in that romantic sense, right? You know, we go find someone, you fall in love, you get close together, and you say, like, we want to have a family together. You know, you have that kind of experience of love, and that's typically what people talk about. Whereas that may incorporate love, that may be a part of it, but it is not necessarily the way that we talk about Christian love. It's not necessarily the way that we understand in our faith what love is, and especially when we talk about God being love, that God is love. That's not the kind of love we're talking about. When you look at the scriptures, they use a couple of different words for love. We have the translation that we get, anytime any of these words are used, it's always love. It's translated in that way. But there's actually three different kinds of words that are used within the scriptures. If you were to take the Greek words, there would be agape, there would be philio, and there would be storge. I think that's how it's pronounced. And then there's another type of love which would be called eros, which is actually more along the lines of what people often in our culture talk about as love. So these different words, I'm going to explain what they mean, don't worry. they really describe different kinds of love. So eros, for example, which is where we get the word erotic from, is a sexual love. So it's that kind of, you know, we know what that is. You know, that's something that's very clear in our culture. But typically, that's what people often think about as love. Love is that feeling, that desire, that passion, you know, like that kind of, that's love. And it's a kind of love, but it's not what we talk about, and in fact, is not one of the terms for love that's ever used in the scriptures. Whenever they're talking about love, they're never talking about that kind of love. Then we look at something like storge. Storge, you know what, I'm going to write these words down just so you can see them up here. So the types of love we have agape, yep, we have phileo, I think it's spelled this way, storge, I might be wrong, and then eros. So you would have eros would be kind of like you know, physical romantic love. Forgot the C in there. Storge would be more of a like a family kind of love, a familial love. So you have the kind of love that in relationships with other people in your family, people who you don't have, you haven't chosen to be friends with, you haven't chosen to be family, right? You know, you I mean, apart from your spouse, but you just grow up in a family. So the people that you are around all the time in that kind of sense, and being around them builds a certain kind of a bond, right? It's a very unique kind of love that you may even sometimes detest each other and be really frustrated with each other, but you still have this kind of bond of love amongst each other. So that would be storge. Then you have phileo, sorry, I'm pronouncing that wrong. I keep doing that. Phileo is more of a friendship kind of love. Now, that is something that, unfortunately, is very highly ignored today, friendship love. I remember when you look at, in the Old Testament, the relationship that David and Jonathan had. So they were, Jonathan was the son of the king, and David was, before David became king, David and him were very, very close friends. They had a very deep loving relationship. Now, what I've seen many times happen, especially more recently, is that people will often refer to them as though it was a homosexual relationship. That people cannot conceive that these two guys were really tight-knit, loving friends without it being sexual, as though somehow it has to be sexual. And that's a misunderstanding between phileo and eros, that they are completely different kinds of love. You know, I have some really great friends where we have an amazing, wonderful friendship. It's very tight and very close. I don't know why it is that in our culture we think every relationship has to be sexual. But it's funny because no one will argue that with family, right? We can make that distinction. You don't see people be like, well, I love my parents. They're like, whoa, that's a little weird. You know, nobody says that. But for some reason, friendship, it's like people think it can't be possible.
But you'll know? Say, you love them like a brother. Is how people will say it.
Yeah, and people will do that because they're trying to get away from, they want to make sure that people know, it's okay, it's this kind of friendship, not this kind, right?
Yeah.
They want to try and make that distinction because they're worried that's what people will think. But we should not discount the wonderful kind of friendship, of phileo friendship, of love. Yes?
I can remember as a young girl, some years back, friends, young girls, we held hands when we were walking somewhere.
Yeah.
There was nothing physical there, but we were good friends.
Yeah.
And nowadays, that would be misconstrued.
Yeah, yeah. Now, if two girls are holding hands, you're going to assume they must be in a sexual kind of relationship.
That's right.
Right. Yeah.
Too bad.
Yeah. It is. It's very unfortunate. But I mean, that is the, you know, the way of the culture. And actually, related to that, one of the reasons I think, I know this is a little off subject, but one of the reasons I think that celibacy in the priesthood is such a beautiful and wonderful thing is that it shows to the world, if lived right, you know, if actually lived celibately, it shows to the world the beauty of this kind of love. Because you can have wonderful, deep relationships, good friendships of love with the people you encounter, and feel safe. So many people don't feel safe. I remember when I first started looking into the priesthood, there was a number of girls that I met who were saying that they were so thankful to have me as a friend because they said, we know you're not going to try and get into our pants. Like we laugh, but it was true. No, they felt a safety around me, knowing that that was not my intention, that I had no directed desire to pursue that kind of a thing. They were saying that any other guy, if they were to hang out with him for a long time, if they were to spend time in a deep conversation with him or anything, that meant he was trying an angle, right? Which is sad that our culture moves in that direction, that so many guys always feel that that's the only reason to ever hang out with a woman. But it gives a beauty to celibacy in the priesthood, is that people know you are what you stand for. Mm-hmm. Now, I mean, of course, you know, the unfortunate thing is that the reality today, many have not lived that out, and so, you know, depending on what kind of encounters people have had with priests or what they've heard about priests in the news, then it gets whitewashed over everyone and that complicates things. But this is something I think we need to recapture more in our culture, is the deep beauty of phileo love, because it's awesome. Agape, though, is a totally different kind of love. And this is the kind of love that God uses in reference to how he loves us and how we're called to love him. Primarily how we're called to love him. So agape love is not one that is through emotion. So again, we can kind of think of love from the sense of affection, right? I feel in love. Right? And that when we talk about falling in love, you know, I think that's actually part of the reason why so many marriages fail today, is that people are looking for the feeling. You know, we don't have that chemistry anymore. We don't seem to, that connection just seems lost. You know, I'm around them and I'm bored. You know, I look at some other, you know, woman down the street and she seems to catch my eye a little bit more. You know, you don't do that for me. I see you all the time. You're not exciting anymore. That kind of a concept of love is misunderstanding the heart of what love really is about. And that we can see with agape is one of a choice. It's a self-sacrificial love. So I'm gonna put here choice and gift of self. So with this, just plugging this back in. What this means is that agape love is really focused on the good of the other. It's a decision, it's an act of the will. So it's something that we choose. We're saying that if I have agape love for someone, I desire their good. I am seeking their good. And that's what's most important. And it becomes a gift of self that you say, I give of myself to you. Not about the return. It has nothing to do with it. It is completely about self-offering. And the kind of the beauty behind what happens with agape love, that self-sacrificial love, is that we find ourselves in it when we give ourselves away. Yes?
Are there common attributes or characteristics common to all four?
Well, it's kind of like the different levels of love, you know, like how deeply, like this is really, in a sense, like, I mean, even with phileo, in friendship sort of love, we still want to give of ourselves as a gift. This can have more the feeling sense a little bit of, you have the bonds of family that you have a certain affection for each other, you know you're important to one another, but a sense, also the same sense, in family love, you love each other even when you are frustrated with each other, right? And I think that's where kind of agape ends up often taking place in a lot of these aspects as well. Except for Eros. Eros is really more just on that romantic. But I mean, well, also, this finds its fulfillment when you really live out agape, right? In the marriage bed, when you really want to give a gift of yourself as opposed to gift for myself, I'm in it just to get pleasure, I'm in it just to receive, but rather when you give fully of yourself, that is that fulfills and elevates this kind of love, because it starts to become more about this. So, really kind of going back to that, when God, I want to give you an example from the scriptures. In the story where St. Peter has, after he's betrayed Jesus, and you have that when he denies him three times, right? Afterward, after Jesus has risen from the dead, and he re-encounters Peter, and he's sitting down by the fire, and he says, Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Okay, feed my sheep. Peter, do you love me? You know, ever wonder why he asks him three times? Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? He asks him three times, and one to kind of combat the three times that he denied him. But secondly, he uses different words for love. He starts off by saying, Peter, do you agape me? Do you agape me? Do you have that self-sacrificial love, that choice of giving your life for me. Do you have that kind of love for me? And Peter responds, Lord, you know that I phileo you. You know that I love you like a friend, that we have that strong bond. And so he says, feed my sheep. Peter, do you agape me? Ask him again, Lord, you know I phileo you. You know I phileo you. Then the third time, Peter, do you phileo me? And that's why Peter gets upset the third time and says, Lord, you know that I phileo you. Because what Jesus does is he lowers the bar to say, okay, I'm going to meet you where you are, Peter. I recognize you're not here yet. Because if he was ready to give his life for Jesus, he wouldn't have denied him, right? Because he was afraid of what would happen. But he still has this bond of love. So he's just checking. Peter, do you really have this kind of love for me? Yes, I have that. Okay. That's where we are.
Is that before the Holy Spirit descended on him?
That was, yeah. Yes.
So that's probably why he hadn't opened up completely, perhaps.
Yeah, well, and that was the thing. That was the huge shift. Once the descent of the Holy Spirit came, Peter just became a transformed man and started going out into the streets and saying, I don't care, getting arrested, doesn't matter, you know? Because agape started happening. Yeah.
The term love is used a lot. Now, what are some concrete characteristics or examples of love, per se?
Of love?
Something concrete.
Just in life in general? In the
instead of just using the word love to cover whatever, what are concrete examples of what love really is concretely?
Yes?
I think one example is a lot of us older ladies here taking care of their husbands when something happens. Mm-hmm. Or having a child who needs that gift of self for the rest of their life. That, to me, is one type of love.
Yeah. Yeah. And so you have, kind of like I said, like, are you asking specifically about agape?
I'm a concrete person, so.
Yeah.
I like kind of specific examples.
Yeah. Are you asking about for each or just agape?
Well, the term love, period. Well, probably the love of Jesus or God would be the biggie.
Okay, so you're talking about agape love.
Probably.
Okay.
And the others also apply as well.
So agape love, an example of agape love would be Jesus giving his life for us on the cross. Right?
There must be more to it than that.
He... More to it than giving his life for us?
Like other characteristics besides that?
Well, the characteristics really are about, that's why I said it's a self-sacrificial love. It's when you say, I give of myself, I choose your good. I desire what's good for you, not for me. So any example of that, so a parent for their children, right? When you're waking up over and over again in the middle of the night to make sure that your child is fed or go to the bathroom or just crying and needs to calm down or whatever it is, if you didn't love your child, if you just considered this child of like what you're getting out of it, because what are you getting out of it at that point? Early parenthood? I've seen my sister. I've seen what happens. Like, you are not getting anything out of the child. When you have to sit there, I've held my nieces and nephews when they're, you know, little babies, and you sit there and you make cooing noises and you talk to them and whatever, and you're like, yeah, this is a one-way street. Like, I can talk to you, but I'm not getting any conversation back. You're not asking how my day is. You know, you're not seeing what's going on. It's all just... You just pour out and you pour out and you pour out and you pour out. That's all you can do. I mean, there are those moments when they smile and it just fills your heart and whatever, you know, things like that. But a lot of it is just tedium of pouring in and pouring in and pouring in. But this is what I was trying to say about the beauty of giving that gift of self. When we pour ourselves out in giving ourselves for other people, we find ourselves. We find completeness and joy. It's as though that's why do parents do it? Yeah, but like you would if there was nothing, if you didn't find some kind of wholeness or completeness in it, you would just say nuts to this. I'm not doing it. I'm not having another one. You're crazy. You go through the pain and suffering of labor. You go through many, many sleepless nights where you don't even know like what's up anymore. You know, you go through all of this turmoil so that you can raise another human being. But the gift is found, and I see that in parents who love. It's the joy of seeing them be themselves, growing up. They're your child. You just love them. There's something that comes out of it that's almost mystical. Now, again, it's different. Sometimes you see parents where it's a very selfish love. I remember seeing a... Do you guys remember those one of those live shows, reality TV series called Super Nanny? Super Nanny? Did anyone see that one?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. We used to have that on sometimes in the background on our TV, and I remember seeing one episode where this family was, you know, of course, they're all at their wits' end. I can't raise my kids. They're a terror, you know, whatever else happened. And here comes Super Nanny to, you know, fix the job. And when they had their interview to talk to her, they said, it's ridiculous. Ever since we had our son, like, our lives are over. You know, we want to go out and go to the movies. We want to go out and, you know, play some pool. We want to hang out with our friends. And this kid is taking up all our time. You know, we're always caring for him. He always wants to eat. He always wants to go do this. He always wants to, like, I have to do everything he wants. Like, can you fix him so that he just tones down? And I felt like saying, when I saw that, I thought, yeah, when you have a kid, yes, your life is over. It's over. Praise God. It's one of the most beautiful gifts that God gives us to teach us about what God's love is like for us. Because when Jesus, that's why I said that the cross is the perfect example of agape love, because Jesus gave that, poured out literally his life for us, when there was nothing in return. From Romans it says, while we were yet sinners, God shows his love for us in that he gave his life for us. While we were sinners. God didn't wait for the opportunity that we were, you know, really holy or earning it or somehow, you know, well adept to receive it. We were just utter failures. We rejected him. We killed him. What bigger rejection is there than that? And yet, he completely gave himself. He didn't run from it. He didn't say, I'm not going to do this. He, you know, the people are taunting him, saying, come down from the cross. If you're really the Son of God, you could come down. Yeah, he could. But he didn't. He could have taken the pain away. But he didn't. He submitted himself fully, because he says, I love you. I agape you. Now, do you think, while he's up there on the cross, that he's feeling like, oh, I just feel such affection for all of them right now. They're so sweet nailing me up here. This just feels so great. You know? Of course not. And when Jesus says that we are to love our enemies, the word he uses is this one, which is great. Because you're going to feel affection and friendship or want to have the kind of bonds of family with someone who has, you know, maybe like, you know, someone, let's say someone's been raped, right? You want to have that kind of relationship with them? No. And often when people see that God says, forgive your enemies, we think, I have to love them like that? It's not going to happen. No, love them like this. It's an ascent of the will, a choice. A choice where we say, I will desire the good for that person. That's what I'm going to hold in my heart, is a desire for the good for that person. That they may be healed, that they may turn from their evil ways, that they may never do that to someone else. And that one day, hopefully, we will be able to meet in heaven. that we will all be reconciled. I mean, then it'll be a different story. But that is really what's meant by that. That's the word that's used for that kind of forgiveness. So, does that clarify a little bit more for you?
Yes.
Yeah?
I was just wondering, another point, could it be the fact that, what is it about that person that I like?
It might help you to say, like, if you have an enemy, to think about, you know, what things do I like about them. But again, you don't have to like someone to love them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, kids know that.
Good answer.
This is recorded, so they're hearing this. Oh my. But yeah, no, you don't have to like someone. You don't have to like, I mean, you take someone who is living continuously in serious sin and who is, you know, let's take Hitler, for example, right? We would be called, I mean, Hitler's dead now, so I mean, it's irrelevant, but if he were in this world right now, we would be called to love him. Yeah.
That's a big one.
It's a big one. That's why I picked one of the biggest ones, because it's the most difficult to relate to with. We're called to love him in the agape sense. Because we should desire the good for him. We should desire that he turn. That he would repent. That he would stop the oppression. That he would stop the murder. That he would stop the genocide. That he would stop all the insanity. We should desire that good. We should desire righteousness. We should desire that, yeah, he should be stopped. You wouldn't just say, like, well, we love him, let him carry on, you know, in the gas chambers and stuff like that. No, stop him. Put him in prison. Capture, like, do you put that tyranny to an end? Absolutely. Why? Out of love. Out of love. Not to say, I hate him, and so we should see that he be hung and that he suffer and that, you know, he gets all the worst coming to him. When we love with agape love, it means that sometimes we have to do hard things out of the good for the other, right? If you really desire someone's good, it means you're not desiring just out of, you know, if you see someone who's suffering, right? We all hate seeing suffering. This comes back to that question of suffering. It's a big one in the world. So we might think when we see someone suffering, I have to put that to an end because I love them. But what we often think when we're seeing suffering is that I don't want to feel this way. I don't like how I feel seeing someone suffer. And so I want to put an end to that feeling and to their feeling of their experience of suffering, which is where the question of, like, euthanasia, for example, comes in today. That people say if we end their life, then they won't be suffering anymore. And so that's the compassionate thing to do. When really what's happening is we're ignoring their good. We have to ask, is that what's good for them? Is that what's right for them? We don't... The objective of our life should not to be to end all possible suffering that should ever happen. We should seek to alleviate it, yes. You know, if you are sick, go to the doctor. You know, get some medicine, get help. If you need to have surgery done, do that. You know, like, we should take care of ourselves. That doesn't mean we don't want to alleviate suffering. But certain kinds of suffering happen because it is a broken world we live in. And it's by going through that suffering and meeting that suffering that there is a greater depth of love that comes out of it. You know, just like Jesus on the cross, he suffered greatly, but he could have just stopped it. He had full capability to just end it. But he didn't because he was showing us his love. He was demonstrating to us his love. And he had to be willing to allow our free choice against him to be enacted. So he didn't stop the people from killing him, from nailing him to the cross, from whipping him, from torturing him, because he wanted to allow them to have their freedom. Because that was more important than the suffering. our freedom to choose. Did you have a question?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, now what kind of love is it then when God put the flood on the earth? Or when he took away the firstborn?
So, that's a good question. I mean, we would talk about there being, it would always be agape love from God. But explaining those situations, we have to understand, I guess, there's sort of a mystery in it of knowing when sin gets so bad. You know, what happens when we look at our world right now and how broken things are? When you see wars breaking out, when we're busy killing ourselves and each other. And that's what was happening in Egypt, right? You know, they were under massive oppression. They were being enslaved unto death. That's what the Egyptians were doing to the Israelites. And the Israelites were calling out to God in prayer, help us, help us. In many ways, it was a mercy for only some of them to die. Right? God could have just said, oh, don't worry, stay in Egypt. I'll just wipe them all out. Then the problem's solved, right? They're just gone. How many times I've heard of people in war-torn situations and in struggles today say, you know, I wish that all the people who were problems would just die. I wish they were just gone, right? Solve all our problems if all the people we disagreed with were just dead. You know? It's not the answer. But, you know, in our minds we often think it's a lot easier. God did not start with the plague of the death of the firstborn. He started with, you know, we're going to have some locusts eating crops. We're going to have, the sky's going to go dark. We're going to, well, before that, even like the making the water turn to blood. You know, those other things that were caused some difficulty to the Egyptians in order to say, like, wake up. Stop oppressing them. Pay attention to what's happening here. And Pharaoh was no. And what did he do? He doubled their work. He said, eventually got to the point that he said, well, now you're going to have to find your own hay to make the bricks. You know, they used to be supplied with the materials so they could make the bricks. But now, nope. You have to find it for yourself, and you still have to make quota. You still have to do as much work as you were doing before. So now he was increasing their labor. And all of the more elderly and the more feeble were being worked to the bone and falling apart, right? Pharaoh was being completely unreasonable. So, you see, if you go through the plagues, the ante was upped each time. A little bit more, a little bit more, a little bit more, a little bit more. Come on, clue in and recognize you can't do this. So it wasn't until the death of the firstborn children that then... finally, Pharaoh woke up and said, get out. That was what finally convinced him. God doesn't delight in that. God doesn't desire that. But sometimes, like a parent disciplining their children, like the whole idea of disciplining when people would do like spankings or that sort of thing. Which, you know, now nobody wants to ever do that. Now, I mean, I'm not saying like hard or anything, but even like a little tap, you know, well, now people will be up in arms about that. But, you know, if your child is absolutely losing it, right? And, or even, let's go to an age where children have, where there's more reason, you know, there's not like, 'cause when you're a little child, you know, you're just, you're a kid. But when you grow up, let's take an example of your kid gets on drugs and has gotten very serious into drugs. And you're trying everything to get them to, like, get out of it. You don't just say, well, que sera. You know, if that makes them happy, do the drugs. That's good. You know, you found your way. whatever. As a parent, you try to do everything you can to get them out of that. You might need to shake them. You might just say, like, you might need to have a big argument with them. You might need to cry and weep with them. You might need to ship them off to a place to get help against their will. You know, if that sort of situation can be done. Of course, you know, it depends on the situation. But you will do what you can to try and wake them up to say, like, this, you are hurting yourself. You are damaging yourself. You're not just going to sit by and do nothing. You do what you can, right? Of course, every situation is different. But that's sort of why sometimes when we hear about things in the scriptures, we go like, wow, that's a heavy hand. But we forget about what led up to that and how God was giving warning after warning after warning after warning after warning. And one of the things I find, I think it's in Kings or Chronicles or somewhere around there. I remember reading one time when I was going through the scriptures, being amazed at seeing like the kind of depravity that the Israelites had fallen into, like the kind of stuff that they were doing. And there's this one passage where, again, I can't remember if it was like Kings or Chronicles, somewhere around there, where God starts kind of going through, here's the things that the Israelites have been doing. And he says, if you've been, you know, if you've been like mistreating each other, I'll still forgive you. And then if you go beyond that and you start stealing from one another, you know, I'll still forgive you. And then even if it gets to the point where you're murdering each other, I will still forgive you. And then if it comes to the point of like you're raping and pillaging and murdering, I will still forgive you. And then when you get to the point of in desperation, you're stealing each other's children and eating them, you know, like it gets dark. It gets dark. The kind of depth to which the Israelites in certain phases of their time that they got into. And God keeps saying, you know, he says, here's the punishments you're going to get. But no, if you turn from your ways, I will forgive you. I will come back to you. It's amazing what God's willing to put up with. And that's the thing that's remarkable. His kind of love is he meets our sin with the appropriate kind of punishment. To wake us up. To get us to pay attention. To start to see what we're doing. Because we're hurting ourselves and we're hurting others. It's against sin that God is reprimanded. So that's what's happening. And that's what's important to understand about agape is sometimes you do things that you would rather not have to do, that would in other circumstances be horrible to do and would be unkind to do, but are what are necessary given the situation. You know, if your child is a great little story that I remember hearing Scott Hahn talk about. For any of you who are familiar with him, he tells a story of his daughter when they were going out, they were out shopping or something. I don't know. They were out in the street, and all of a sudden his daughter just like seemed to suddenly turn and went out into the street, and a truck was coming, and he, without thinking, just reacted and grabbed her arm and yanked her back off the street as fast as he could and just narrowly missed this truck coming in that would have killed his daughter. And she looked up at him with big tears in her eyes and she said, "Daddy, you're hurting my arm." And I saved your life! You know, you realize what I just pulled you from. Like, that's, you know, I'm sorry your arm is hurt, but that's not what, I wasn't, my goal was not to hurt your arm. My goal was to pull you out of harm's way. And I think that really exemplifies how the Father's love for us, that agape love, sometimes has that suffering. We feel we're focused on that one part of my arm hurts. We're stuck on that, not seeing the full picture of what God is saving us from and what he's doing. And sometimes some of those things we can't fully understand until the next life. But is that kind of helping everybody understand the agape love? So there you go. I want to just conclude here by reading, so I think it's helpful when we got that online, 1 Corinthians 13, where it talks about what is love. This is one of the passages that's used very commonly at weddings, which is interesting because people typically think about it. It's used at weddings because people think like, oh, you know, love. And they don't realize that this passage, what it's really saying is this is what it means for Christian virtue to love with full sacrifice, to say, I give my life over to you unto death. You know, it is appropriate for weddings too, but it's really talking about how we love God. And I think is great if we have that as a focus in weddings, but you know, because typically it's more like it's the love we have. Sorry, I'm terrible. Okay, so 1 Corinthians 13, verses 4 to 7. Love is patient and kind. Think about it, patience. You're not patient for yourself. You're willing to put up and be patient for someone else. Again, it's that choice. Love is not jealous or boastful, right? Because jealousy says, not fair, I want X, Y, or Z. Or boastful saying, again, it's about me. It's the choice for the other, for the good of the other. It is not arrogant or rude, right? Arrogance, again, about me. Rudeness, because you've offended me. Right? Love does not insist on its own way. Obvious. It is not irritable or resentful. Irritable in the sense that we get irritated because we want our way and we don't want to do someone else's way. And resentful because now I'm bitter because I didn't get my way. Right? It does not rejoice at wrong, but rejoices in the right. Because it's in accord with truth. When you desire the good for someone, you want to rejoice in what is good and right. Not over what I feel or would prefer. Right? Love bears all things. Is willing to bear all things, believes all things, is willing to believe in and seek, now again this is primarily in terms of God, hopes all things and endures all things. It's all that focus on the other. You see that? Really, you know, you go through hell for love. You walk in the midst of destruction for love. You walk at the expense of your own life for love. Say it's all for the one whom I love. That's what love really is about. So, for our questions, what I'd like you to discuss in your groups, checking the time here. What I'd like you to discuss in your groups is, you know, first of all, what did you think? Has this illuminated anything for you about your understanding of love? And maybe how have you seen examples of especially agape love in your own life in ways that maybe you didn't know, ways that people loved you, And does this change your perspective of how God loves you as well? You know, the way that God's love is not like our love, because this is another short little thing. We often, when we think about, because we call God our Father, we think about God in terms of, in human terms, of how our fathers were, right? And so we sometimes put that on God, the way that my father didn't love me the way he was supposed to. And somehow that's how God loves me. And so we get that kind of misunderstood perspective because we're thinking in human terms and how we have failed in love, as opposed to seeing it, God, it's not like that for him. God loves us completely and perfectly for our good. Not out of any selfishness, and he's not going to run away. He's not going to disappear. His love is completely unearned. You know, it's the other beautiful thing about love is that we think of love like, you know, I have to prove myself in love, right? If I do X, Y, and Z, I show I'm worthy of love. But by the definition of agape love, it has zero to do with you. Nothing to do with you, right? Do you love your babies because they've done something for you, that they've accomplished something, some great feat? They're just there. They got born. That's all they did. They're just passively going through everything. You love them because you've chosen to love them. It's about the lover. The lover decides that I love you. And so that's how it reveals to us, you know, what that love really is that God has for us, in how he loves us. So anyway, discuss. I want to bring up one last thing here. Because I forgot, there was something that I missed out last time, or I think I can explain a little bit better last time when we talked about the Trinity, which very much fits in with our discussion about love. So one of the things is a helpful way of understanding between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit is that God, how God is love, you know, we'd say, how is it that God is love in his very being? It's that for him to be love, you always need a lover, the one who loves, who pours out his whole self, gives his whole life to the beloved, right? So he's got that self-sacrificial love where he directs and gives everything to the Son, to his beloved, who gives everything to the Father, right? And then there is the love that is between them, that is the Holy Spirit. So that might be a helpful illustration of understanding a little bit better the idea behind the Trinity. And the other thing, when I talked about person and being, right? And the difference between God being one being, one God, but three persons. I think it's a little bit helpful to think of it, a person is the who we're talking about, right? Because we would say, who are you? And you'd say, your name, that's me. I am this particular person, right? But what are you? I'm a human being. That's what I am. Now, I mean, it's also who I am at the same time, too, so I mean, that completely, and the same goes for God. We say, who is he? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Three, what is he? God. That's his being. Is that might help a little bit. I think like it might have saved some pain by describing a little more that way.
I like the first one better.
What's that?
I like the first one better.
Oh, yeah, well, no, but this is to help understand person and being, not in terms of how the Trinity works in terms of love. But that, anyway, whatever works for you. Whatever works for you.